about the welfare of children and young people in those sports, to talk about their concerns, get help and assistance as well.
The coming months may be deeply uncomfortable for football, but those players facing their demons now may help others avoid similar abuse in future. Paul Kelso, Sky News.
Well, for more on this, we're joined by Gabrielle Shaw, the Chief Executive of the National Association for People Abused in Childhood. Gabrielle, thanks very much for being with us. Once again, it has taken a few brave individuals to come forward, to give their story, to reveal once again child abuse on a huge scale in yet another area of public life.
It has indeed. And it does take an enormous amount of bravery to come forward. And we congratulate Andy Woodward for his courage in doing so. And it does have an effect. We already know that more famous footballers, as the report says, have come forward. But on our NAPAC helpline, we have noticed in the last week, since Andy Woodward spoke out, a doubling of the amount of men who have called our NAPAC helpline to talk about the abuse they've suffered as children, and also a doubling of the amount of men looking at our NAPAC website. So when people like this come forward, it really does shine a light on the scale of the issue.
Obviously, you can't speak about individual cases, but from the information you've managed to gather from calls to the helpline, when do these cases of abuse seem to have taken place? Is there a geographical factor to all of this as well?
Yes, I can't speak about individual cases, as you say, but generally there is quite a few years lag before people can feel the courage to come forward. So we're talking in sort of age range of men and women in their 30s to 50s is the kind of the age we're talking about abuse that has happened to them when they were children. As to the geographical scope of it, it is all over the country. And I think, as someone said in the report earlier, there is a lot more to come out about this. But I would also make the point that it's not limited to football. I don't think there's any sport out there that can be comfortable and say, this never happens, has happened to us. Because abuse happens when power meets vulnerability. And you've got that in any sport, indeed any walk of life, and perpetrators will prey upon the vulnerable. So I think not just football, but all sports should be looking at this and trying to work out the appropriate response.
Indeed, I suppose some people would suggest that perhaps we should have been able to predict this, that we should have been able to see this coming. Men in positions of authority with young, idealistic, ambitious young men within their purview.
Absolutely. That's because what perpetrators and abusers do, they can spot the vulnerability. And they're in positions of power. These young children, they're chasing the dream. They're chasing the footballing dream, for instance. And they'll do anything to do it. And so the abusers will just prey upon that. And the effect that this has on these children and into their adult lives does last a lifetime. Andy Woodward has spoken about this. We know that callers to our NAPAC helpline suffer with addictions, drug abuse, self-harming, low self-esteem, and it also impacts upon the family relationship. So the abuser hasn't just hurt that child at that time, but it echoes throughout their lives and the lives of their families too. It is really invidious.
Of course, clearly this is a problem that affects many, many areas of public life. But just speaking specifically about football for a second, in your mind, how has the Football Association responded to this? Has this been something that they have been aware of for some time? Have they been spurred into action by recent confessions? What's your assessment of where they are with this?
I don't think they've been particularly proactive to date. I think, as you say, they've been spurred into action by the most recent event over the last couple of weeks in particular. And, you know, they're setting up a helpline, for instance. But I think it's a lot of it is after the fact. And I think there's a lot more to be done. And by that I mean the Football Association should work with the players, the Footballing Players Association as well, to set up an environment where people can come forward and can feel comfortable coming forward. Because what we know is that those who have been abused have often tried to disclose previously and have not been believed. So the Football Association needs to provide an environment where people feel safe and secure to come forward. And I would also urge people too, as well as that helpline that's been discussed and the support that's out there, if they feel comfortable, to report the abuse to the police, because the abuser may still be out there and may still be posing a risk to children today.
And what of the parents in all of this? You know, I'll confess, I recently became a father myself to a young boy. I'm looking forward to the day when I can take him along to football training or rugby training, but The fact that we continue to see these stories emerging means that at the back of my mind, perhaps at the front of my mind, is am I willing to let my child go into someone else's care for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours every week?
Indeed, and it's a major concern. I think the environment has changed over recent years. There's most football clubs, rugby clubs, etc., will have much better safeguarding policies, much better risk assessments, etc. But the issue is, and you can have all the policies, all the safeguarding procedures you like, but it must be a living thing. It must go throughout that club. Everyone is aware of it, so it's not just a tick box exercise, a piece of paper that you just know. Yes, we've got a policy, and that's it. So there's awareness and that constant communication that goes on. I don't think it should drive people away from taking their children to football or rugby, etc. But do ask, talk to the club. What are your safeguarding policies? How do you make sure that it's a living thing and that children are safe? And so for parents out there, don't be afraid to communicate, to ask the hard questions, because that means you're playing your part too in keeping people safe.
Good advice. Gabrielle Shaw, the Chief Executive of the National Association for People Abused in Childhood. Thanks for joining us here on Sky News.
About sexual abuse, how children are being treated in football.
In the past or now?
Past and present as well. So this is really beginning to open up some quite serious concerns about what's been happening historically. And if there are children who are victims of abuse today, then this programme will be very helpful in messaging out a very clear message to the public to say, if you have concerns about children in football, then you must come to us now so we can bring potential individuals who might be threatening children to account.
And that was the NSPCC. Well, the former Manchester City and England player David White has become the latest player to say he was abused. The 49-year-old says former Crewe coach Barry Bennell, a convicted paedophile, abused him at Whitehill FC, a junior team based in Manchester. White is the fourth player now to waive his right to anonymity to talk about what happened to him. In a statement issued by him, he says, "For a number of reasons and for nearly two decades, I kept my ordeal secret from my family and friends. Throughout my football career, I believed that I had come to terms with what had happened in my childhood. But I now know that the effects of Bennell's behavior were much more profound than I had thought. I need to emphasize, though, that I do not feel brave. Despite the far-reaching ramifications of 1979 to 1980, I believe I was one of the luckier ones." He says, "Circumstances took me away from the abuse before it escalated to levels that I now know others had to endure." And he continues, "I salute Andy Woodward, Steve Walters and Paul Stewart for waiving anonymity in order to reveal their personal tragedies. The physical abuse that they and others suffered was certainly more extreme and prolonged than my ordeal, and I cannot be sure that I'd have had the courage to come forward." That statement from David White. And we hope to be talking to our sports correspondent, Natalie Perks, who's at Wembley, where that meeting about sexual abuse in football is going on right now. In the last hour, Andy Woodward, a player who says he was abused as a youngster at Crewe Alexandra, spoke to the BBC on his way into a meeting with the FA at Wembley.
"I've been in tears loads and I was emotional, you know. And now this has come and there has been a lot of people come out, which I'm so grateful for, and I, you know, heartfelt that the lads have really sort of had the courage to do this, and that's what the intention was. And now it's going to grow and grow, because I do believe that there's so many more out there that eventually will pluck up the courage. I think it's a slow process, it's going to take some time. So what I want out of this today is to go and see the FA and just see what they are looking to do long term in terms of us victims, because, you know, we're still suffering. I am now, you know, I've had breakdowns even this last week. I've had panic and anxiety, you know, especially doing these reports. As much as I seem like I'm dead calm inside, I'm really sort of like suffering. So I'd want something in terms of that, really."
Andy Woodward, and let's talk now to our sports correspondent, David Ornstein, who's at Wembley, where that meeting is taking place. And David, just take us through what exactly the FA is saying at this point.
Well, the FA have said very little, Anita. They formed part of a statement with the NSPCC in which the FA's head of equality and safeguarding, Sue Ravenlaw, said the courage and dignity showed by the footballers who have spoken out so far was immense. And that's about it from the FA's point of view. As we know from there, the FA are meeting with Andy Woodward as we speak. So perhaps we'll hear something a little later on. Part of the FA's role as the governing body of English football is to make sure that people who should not be working in football are not working in football. The FA have made contact with the relevant footballing bodies, such as the Professional Footballers Association and also the police, and they're open to further dialogue, I'm told. However, no further detail and also no comment from the FA at this stage on why there was no investigation set up in 1998 when Barry Bennell, the coach named by Andy Woodward, was convicted of child abuse offences. So the FA relatively tight-lipped at the moment. They were, however, praised by the NSPCC for their role in funding setting up this 24-hour hotline, which anybody can come forward to. So it seems from Andy Woodward's comments there that this perhaps is just the tip of the iceberg. Four former footballers have come forward so far. Cheshire police say 11 people have been in contact with them, and 50 calls in the first 2 hours of operation to the NSPCC helpline. 20 of those contained information that was referred on to the police. So an incredibly worrying story, this, and one that we certainly haven't heard the last of yet.
Certainly, David, and there must be a concern, as you've just mentioned, 50 calls in the first 2 hours of that helpline. There must be a concern that more cases are going to come to light. And I wonder what the footballing world is saying about the situation now with regards to young players in the game and safeguarding, as to whether they believe that young boys and girls could be vulnerable to exploitation still.
Andy Woodward said that this was one of the most pressing concerns. Footballers to this day, young players, are desperate to make it in football and therefore potentially more vulnerable than children in any other walk of society. The chief executive of the PFA, Gordon Taylor, told me yesterday that the level of protection and support now offered by the game and by the clubs is unrecognisable compared to what it was at the time. But can this ever be rooted out 100%? Surely the answer to that is no, and that's something that the FA and the authorities need to address. We've also heard from the sports minister today, Tracy Crouch, and she says that the former players had shown incredible bravery to speak about the abuse. But the shadow sports minister, Dr. Rosina Aline Khan, she's warned that the scandal could seriously damage the reputation of football in the UK, and we know the value of football in this country. It's the most watched league in the world in terms of the Premier League and the vast amounts of money. You know, the Premier League recently struck an £8 billion television deal, but at the heart of it is integrity, and then going down into the youth ranks is safeguarding. And that will be a hot topic of conversation now. And this is seriously, it seems like, only just getting started.
Okay, David, for the moment, thank you very much. To historic child sexual abuse cases in England and Wales, according to figures obtained by the BBC. New figures show 27 inquiries have been completed. It could mean disciplinary action for up to 15 officers. The Independent Police Complaints Commission says it's continually receiving more allegations. Here's our Home Affairs correspondent, Tom Simons.
In Rotherham, police failed to stop the widespread sexual grooming and abuse of teenagers. In fact, an independent report concluded the evidence it was going on was suppressed. Now South Yorkshire Police is being investigated itself, one of 18 forces where officers are accused of failing to properly investigate child sexual abuse. The number of these inquiries being handled by the Independent Police Complaints Commission has been rising steadily. In total, there are 187. Rotherham means South Yorkshire Police is the subject of 56 inquiries. Essex Police is facing 58 cases, and the Metropolitan Police 46. 27 cases have been completed, with 13 officers facing disciplinary proceedings and two already disciplined. In London, many of the cases involved the claim that investigations were closed down when police discovered connections to MPs or other prominent people. The police watchdog says it's examining allegations of historic high-level corruption. But in May, one claim that a prosecution was stopped when a defendant threatened to name the former Prime Minister, Sir Edward Heath, as an abuser, was dismissed by the IPCC. The suggestion that the powerful have been protected by the police is far from being proven. Tom Simons, BBC News.
players could potentially have been abused as children. Well, I'm joined by Emily Cherry, the head of participation at the NSPCC. You've started up a dedicated phone line today, haven't you? What kind of response have you had so far?
So the helpline has been open today in response to these allegations that have been made, and we're working with the FA to make sure that any instances of abuse in football that has happened historically are listened to, are believed and then passed on for investigation. We've had a huge response already to helpline, and we would encourage and urge anyone who's got information about people who were abused in childhood during football that they come forward with that information.
You say a huge response. How many have run so far, do you know?
So in the first 2 hours of the helpline being open, we had over 50 calls. That's one of the highest responses in terms of a helpline kind of call out. So it is really important that if anyone has that information, that they come forward and they will be believed and there is support available for them.
Are you surprised by the response that you've had? I mean, as you say, it's the biggest response that you've had on any kind of dedicated phone line.
So I don't think we're surprised by the response, but I think what's really important here to emphasise is that, you know, anywhere that has the opportunity and the access to children, there is the potential for child abuse to happen. You know, if football itself is a masculine-dominated environment, sexual abuse is particularly difficult for boys and men to talk about. So the fact that this has been happening during the 80s and 90s, it is not a shock to us, but it's so important that people come forward. But what's really also important to emphasise is the FA particularly has been working really hard over the last few years to make sure that it's got the highest standards of safeguarding policies, procedures and expectations in place, and that clubs need to absolutely work to their highest level to make sure children are kept safe.
Mm. Do you think this could possibly become a sort of, the sort of Jimmy Savile moment for sport, that we could see not just football but a lot of people coming forward who were involved in all sorts of different sports in their childhoods?
I think we will see more victims come forward, and you know, the courage and the bravery of those initial footballers with speaking out has already started to encourage more people to come forward, and that's why it's so vital that this helpline has been opened, that is dedicated and is there for child abuse victims. It went in, they were children playing in sport, and particularly football is open for people to call now.
Has anything changed in football since the 80s and 90s, when a lot of these allegations date back to?
We've been working really hard with the NSPCC and the FA, so we actually have our own dedicated child protection and sport unit which works with all governing bodies across sport. They will help sport to make sure that they have the highest expectations and safeguarding policies in place. But parents also particularly play a very key role here in making sure that their children are safe in the sporting clubs and the environments they go into. So knowing the right questions to ask when your child is joining a club, making sure that those policies and procedures and the environment is safe for your child to be in, and then also having conversations with your child around sexual abuse. That sounds like a really scary thing to do, but the NSPCC actually has a brilliant tool called PANTS, or the underwear rule, which you'll find on our website, and that encourages you to have an early conversation and equip your child with the knowledge of what's safe and what's not safe.
You talk about the right questions that parents need to ask when they get their children involved in these kind of sports. It's difficult, isn't it, because so many sports are parents are involved, as well as people who are officially involved in sports. So many times it's other families, it's friends who are going to give your child a lift, or you're going to give their children a lift. You're surely not suggesting that people, you know, get their friends' criminal record checked and things like that, are you?
It's so important that any sport has the right kind of procedures and policies in place, and those exist through the FA. But this is also about the dual role of making sure your children know what's expected and what's safe behaviour and what's not safe behaviour, and encouraging them to speak up, but also doing those checks and having those conversations. We can't create environments in which child abuse can flourish, and that's when you create secrecy, don't have open conversations. And that's why if we all work together, so that be that coaches, be that governing bodies, be that parents, and make sure that child abuse does not have a place in sporting environment.
Okay, Emily Cherry from the NSPCC, thank you.
Thank you.
It's called for an inquiry into the sexual abuse of young players.
It follows claims from three former professional footballers that they were abused by a paedophile convicted over attacks at football clubs in the northwest in the 1980s and 90s. The PFA says there may be many more victims.
In regards to the amount of people that come forward in a short space of time, makes me feel that this is the tip of the iceberg. So I personally feel that this has been going on. People have suffered alone in silence for years, And I think the catalyst being Andy coming forward is giving everyone confidence to come for themselves. And I think we'll find a number of players, former members, will start to come forward.
Well, our sports correspondent Paul Kelso has more.
David White was a star for Manchester City in England in the 1990s, but he was hiding a dark secret. Now he's become the latest footballer to claim he was abused by convicted paedophile Barry Bennell, a coach who worked at clubs across the Northwest. First to speak out was Andy Woodward, who says he was repeatedly abused by Bennell while at Crewe Alexandra.
Football's the most beautiful game in the world, but there has been some evil coaches within football, and I do believe it's going to be something really big in terms of how many people have suffered.
Woodward's teammate Steve Walters has also spoken about Bennell, and former England and Liverpool striker Paul Stewart has alleged he was abused by an unnamed coach. Accounts like these have led 11 people to approach Cheshire Police with information about alleged abuse in the national game. The case has focused attention on the safeguards in an industry where youth development is central and thousands of children are chasing a dream. And it's left the authorities searching for an appropriate response.
The shocking accounts of abuse from former players in the past week are unlikely to be the last. And the Football Association, working with the NSPCC, is to launch a hotline to make it easier for people to come forward in future. But after the exposure of child abuse scandals in other areas of public life, it is now football's turn to confront its past.
This is familiar territory for campaigners who hope others will now come forward.
We know that there is a strong macho culture in football and possibly in many other sports as well. So it's very difficult for victims of sexual abuse to come forward. Our helpline service is available for victims to speak out, but also for other people who are concerned about the welfare of children and young people in those sports, to talk about their concerns, get help and assistance as well.
The coming months may be deeply uncomfortable for football, but those players facing their demons now may help others avoid similar abuse in future. Paul Kelso, Sky News.
Well, in response to those allegations made by the former professional footballers, we have had a statement from the Sports Minister, Tracy Crouch. It reads, the players that have broken their silence to speak out about the abuse they suffered have shown incredible bravery. The safety and security of participants in sports at every level is absolutely paramount. Sports governing bodies, clubs and coaches have a clear duty of care to young people who attend sports clubs. As she concludes, the Child Protection and Sport Unit has standards for safeguarding and protecting children in sport that sports organisations have to adhere to. Plenty more on this throughout the afternoon here on Sky News.
Well, players have come forward to say they were abused by coaches when they were boys. Well, the FA is meeting at Wembley this lunchtime to discuss the revelations, and they'll be hearing from Andy Woodward, who was the first player to come forward. Our sports correspondent Natalie Perks is there for us this afternoon. Natalie.
Well, Woodward arrived here this morning hoping the FA would not only hear his story, but truly listen and work out what they could do to support victims going forward. Now, since he came out last week to discuss the abuse he'd suffered, three other former players also came forward to tell their stories. And Andy Woodward knows that the abuse he suffered at the hands of a serial paedophile is now not an isolated case. Indeed, he believes it may well be the tip of an iceberg.
The face of a self-confessed monster. Barry Bennell was a youth coach at Crewe Alexandra in the 80s and 90s. He's been jailed three times for child sex abuse, including once in America, where police said he had an insatiable appetite for young boys. He used his victims' dreams of becoming professional footballers to control them. Andy Woodward was one of them. He arrived at Wembley today to talk to the FA and told me he's heartened that others are now coming forward.
It's been inside my stomach all these years, and I thought, so one day I'll get them. And I have, and they're coming out now. And this is a legacy, this. I tell you, this, you have no idea how big this is. And I really do hope they take me seriously, because all us out there, we've all been crying the last week. It's not fair, is it? And we didn't ask for this, all of us, and we've suffered.
Since he told his painful story last week, three other footballers have come forward to speak about abuse they suffered, not only at the hands of Bennell. Former England player Paul Stewart was abused by an unnamed coach. He told the BBC today he expects many, many others to speak out.
My hope would be that it isn't as widespread as a Jimmy Savile, then I know that not as many have suffered, but my belief is that there's hundreds.
Hello, your food to the NSPC.
The FA has praised the victim's immense courage and set up a dedicated phone line with the NSPCC. Since it launched this morning, they've had a steady stream of callers, but the charity says a culture needs to change within football.
What we still need is an ongoing change in the culture in clubs, moving away from that kind of macho sense that's very prevalent in the game, so children have the confidence to be able to speak out, be listened to and be taken seriously with club officials.
The question now, though, is just how far does this scandal go?
Well, you heard Jimmy Savile being mentioned there, and that is the real fear now, that this could become even bigger than that. It's important to note that some of the calls to the NSPCC hotline today have not just been historic allegations. Some have been about potential abuse that could be being suffered today. And as more former players are set to speak out, we understand, the spotlight will shine brighter on the governing body about whether football is failing in its duty of care.
Natalie, thank you very much indeed. Natalie Perks there. Failures in dealing with child sexual abuse. 27 inquiries have been completed, resulting in potential disciplinary action against up to 15 officers. Well, our Home Affairs correspondent Tom Simons is in central London for us right now. Tom, just give us some more details on this.
Well, these investigations carried out by the Independent Police Complaints Commission are into a wide variety of what are alleged to be failings of police officers to deal with child sexual abuse, largely in the distant past. Now, the numbers are swelled by three different areas of the country. The first, South Yorkshire, being investigated for failings in the Rotherham child grooming case, which came to light a couple of years ago. The second, Essex, a string of complaints, more than 50, relating to one single investigation, as I understand it. And then the Metropolitan Police, also facing a similar number of complaints, relating to a wide variety of allegations. Now, in London, those complaints are often alleged to be situations where police investigations are closed down or downgraded because prominent people have been identified as part of the investigation, in some cases MPs. Now, the interesting thing is that those investigations continue. They're highly confidential and controversial. But in one case, Wiltshire Police decided recently that there was no evidence to suggest that an investigation was closed down when Sir Edward Heath, the former Prime Minister, his name had become linked to that investigation. So I think we're a long way from the suggestion that the police have covered up for prominent people.
Tom, thank you very much indeed. That's Tom Simons there, our Home Affairs correspondent.
Seriously, because all us out there, we've all been crying the last week. It's not fair, is it? We didn't ask for this, all of us, and we've suffered.
Since he told his painful story last week, three other footballers have come forward to speak about abuse they suffered, not only at the hands of Bennell. Former England player Paul Stewart was abused by an unnamed coach. He told the BBC today he expects many, many others to speak out.
My hope would be that it isn't as widespread as a Jimmy Savile, then I know that not as many have suffered, but my belief is that there's hundreds.
Hello, your food to the NSPCC.
The FA has praised the victim's immense courage and set up a dedicated phone line with the NSPCC. Since it launched this morning, they've had a steady stream of callers, but the charity says a culture needs to change within football.
What we still need is an ongoing change in the culture in clubs, moving away from that kind of macho sense that's very prevalent in the game, so children have the confidence to be able to speak out, be listened to and be taken seriously with club officials.
The question now, though, is just how far does this scandal go?
Well, that is the question. So let's speak to Mike Harthill, who's a sports sociologist at Edgehill University, who's specialised in child protection in sport over the last 15 years and joins us now from Salford. Thanks for being with us. I mean, is there enough child protection, brutally, in the world of sport and especially football?
Well, it's enough child protection. That we have a lot of child protection policy within sports, across all sports, and certainly including football. And the FA has perhaps committed more resources to child protection than any other organisation. Certainly the UK is recognised as leading the world on this issue. However, do we have enough child protection? I don't think we have enough knowledge and enough awareness about child abuse within sports. I don't think the sports community in Britain, and certainly across the rest of the world, is educated enough about the dangers, the risks that that sports can present. And I don't think there's yet enough willingness to for adults who are made aware of abuse to come forward and report it.
Yeah, and the scale of this abuse is just now really beginning to become clear as more and more people come forward, really. But I suppose what you have here is a lot of young people, and there is an assumption of trust, isn't there, that the adults coaching them, looking after them, directing them in whatever sporting activity it is, whether it's football or anything else, there is an assumption of trust by parents and everybody else.
Yes, yeah, there is, and I think that obviously in the vast majority of cases, adults involved in sport are well-meaning and want to do the best for children. But we do know that that there is also a great deal of abuse that has gone on in sport. I think it's now time for sport governing bodies to go beyond implementing policy and being sort of policy adherent, and start to find out the extent of abuse that has occurred and is still occurring in their sports. So we need governing bodies, especially those with perhaps deeper pockets than the most, to implement some robust prevalence research. We need to know, the first thing we really need to know and should already know, is the extent of abuse in football or in cricket or in swimming, because unless we have that robust scientific data, we don't have a platform from which to move forward on.
But at the same time, I guess, you know, you can't afford to wait, perhaps, for all that data to be produced. And you do need rules and regulations, but at the same time, you don't want to tie football clubs or sporting associations, you don't want to tie them down with too many rules and regulations. What's the balance?
Well, there are national standards in place that the NSPCC has been has formulated with Sport England. We have all sports clubs, at least those affiliated to Sport England, have child protection policies in place. The majority of clubs will have a child welfare officer in place, so there's a structure in place. The balance, in terms of balance, well, the balance is about keeping children safe and doing whatever is required to ensure that the cases like the ones we've been hearing about this week don't happen again.
Good to talk to you. Thank you very much. That's Mike Harthill, a sports sociologist at Edgehill University. Thank you.
To look into these really, really shocking and challenging tales of child abuse, but because there is a police investigation that is underway. We heard from Cheshire Police yesterday who say that so far, at that point, 11 people had come forward with information, and the Cheshire Police have asked for the FA to support that inquiry. I think we'll hear that the FA's view is that at this stage it is right that they let the police take the lead. Barry Bennell, the convicted paedophile at the heart of this story, wasn't just active in football. He worked in holiday camps. He worked with clubs and children's homes, we understand. So the police may be following leads that go in many directions. So for now, that will be the FA's position. They've been meeting here at Wembley this afternoon with the man, the footballer, who very bravely started this whole process, Andy Woodward, who spoke out, gave an interview to The Guardian last week, which was the trigger, really. It unblocked this dam that has seen a number of his fellow professionals, former pros, three more on the record. Very rare in child abuse inquiries for people to speak on the record, but they followed him and spoken on the record, and many others come forward to speak. And he said, Andy Woodward, he was very satisfied with what he heard from Greg Clark, the FA chairman. He believes that the FA is taking seriously his request that those who are speaking out now, the victims, get all the support they can. Andy Woodward less worried about what the FA did looking back. He wants victims to be looked after. He did, though, say, did warn that he believes there is a live danger from some people who were involved in the abuse of players when he was coming through the system that are still at large now. And that is something I'm sure the police will want to look into. The FA launched a helpline with the NSPCC this morning to give you another idea of the scale of this story and how it is gathering momentum. In the first 2 hours, 50 people called that helpline, which is established expressly for the purpose of footballers or those involved in football to come forward. And the NSPCC spoke to us about the impact they hope this helpline can have.
So in the first 2 hours of the helpline being open, we had over 50 calls. That's one of the highest responses in terms of a helpline kind of call out. So it is really important that if anyone has that information, that they come forward and they will be believed and there is support available for them.
So the NSPCC, they're clearly pleased, if that is the right word, with the fact this helpline has had an impact. The FA managed to get this helpline up and running inside 72 hours. I suppose one question that might be asked is why there wasn't perhaps some kind of facility for victims of abuse in place. But this has taken the football industry a little unawares, and they are at the moment trying to find the appropriate response. We've seen, haven't we, in the last year or two, various sectors, various areas of public life having to face up to the reality of dark chapters and child abuse within those areas. And it is now very clearly football's turn to face that, and I hope to be able to speak to the FA chairman, bring you what he has to say, Greg Clark, in the next couple of hours with the FA's formal response to a story that has a long way to run.
We look forward to that from you. Thanks very much.
Concerns about sexual abuse in football on the first morning of its operation. Several former players have come forward to say they were abused by coaches when they were boys. Well, in the last few moments, the former Crewe Alexandra player Andy Woodward, who says he was abused by his former football coach, has spoken to the BBC after leaving a meeting with Football Association chairman Greg Clark.
I was really nervous about going, to be honest with you, because it was quite a daunting experience going to see the FA just a few weeks ago, where, you know, I was sat in my lounge crying with Zelda, and to go there, to go to such a big place, I was worried. But I've got to say, when I went there, they were nothing but encouraging. I felt really sort of relieved somewhat that they sat down and they are taking it extremely serious. They are going to do things and they are going to put things in place and they want to move forward with this. And I met Greg Clark and he made me feel really comfortable. It was in a comfortable environment and he said that they will turn over every stone and that they've got my back as much as they can.
Are they planning an investigation into this?
I don't know about an investigation. I think they're going to look into it, but that's not my concern right now. My concern is not looking back. It's looking what we can do now and what we can do to put in place to protect these children, even at grassroots. And then also, more importantly for me and my, I call them my friends, but my mates have suffered and they've assured me that they're going to do everything they can to help all us, because we're all victims and we're still suffering. It's like me now, I'm stood here and I sound like really calm, but inside I'm having anxiety attacks, and I've got to do this for us. And they've assured me that they are going to do everything they can for every single player. And that's what I went in there for, nothing else, just so we can be protected. And the kids and the parents now that are out there, we all should be protected. And we can't 100% protect that, but we can certainly do more, can't we?
Andy Woodward there. Well, let's get more on this story. We can discuss it with Gabriel Shaw, who's chief executive of NAPAC, the National Association for People Abused in Childhood. She joins me from our central London studio. Thank you very much for being with us this afternoon. I was just looking at a statement that's been put out by the sports minister, Tracy Crouch, who says the players that have broken their silence to speak out about the abuse they suffered have shown incredible bravery. No doubt you would agree with that.
Oh, absolutely. It takes enormous courage to do that, because it's not like, you know, reporting a theft or something minor like that. To speak out about what happened to you means reliving the trauma and bringing it all up again, and that's incredibly difficult. So yes, the courage and the bravery is immense.
And for most of us, hearing about this scale of possible abuse within the sporting field will come as something of a surprise. I don't know what you've made of what we've been hearing over the last few weeks.
Yes, at NAPAC we obviously hear from thousands of survivors every year, and they tell of abuse through all spheres of life, including sport. Because let's remember, abuse happens where power meets vulnerability, and the sporting field, football, is no different. You have people in positions of power, coaches, etc., and you have vulnerability, children who are desperate to play, who really want and love the game and want to move forward with it. And unfortunately, you have abusers like Barry Bennell, who abused Andy Woodward, who will take advantage of that. I think as well, the scale and the scope of it is yet to emerge properly in football and other sports too. So I think there'll be more revelations to come.
Have you seen any changes to the kind of people getting in touch with your helpline?
Oh, yes, indeed. Usually the gender split between men and women seeking help on our helpline, or indeed on our NAPAC website, which has resources, is usually around sort of 70% female, 30% male. In the last week, since the Andy Woodward was the first to come forward and subsequently others, we've seen almost a doubling in the amount of men seeking help, both from our helpline and our website. And that's quite common, because all too often survivors think, I'm the only one this happened to, no one else can understand. And when they see someone who they can identify with, it almost is like a permission is given, oh, I'm not the only one, I can come forward and seek help. So for that reason, the bravery of Andy Woodward and others is that it has a real meaning and purpose, because it does change others' lives.
And when it comes to people who are reaching out for help after so long, we heard Andy Woodward there saying he's still suffering, and he said he looks fine on the outside, but he feels anxious and so on. What kind of treatment, what kind of support and help can adults receive?
It was a really powerful point that Andy Woodward made there, that you live with the effects of abuse, you carry it with you, and all too often we know that people suffer with mental health difficulties, with addiction issues, intimacy issues and so forth. Unfortunately, we also know that the support that's needed, and that could be anything from counselling to therapy, etc., is just in no way meets the demand that's out there. So when Andy Woodward spoke about the FA saying we will support every player with what they need, that is really good news. But unfortunately, that does not cover the absolute need that's out there. We need more frontline services. We need more specialists, because this is a specialist area, being able to help someone, an adult who's been abused in childhood. But I think this is a really good step, and for football to face up to it. And I would also just say that if other sports think they're immune, that this doesn't happen in our sport, I don't think they can be comfortable saying that. Again, go back to the context of what happens. I think everyone should be doing more to look into this.
Okay, Gabriel Shaw from NAPAC, thank you very much indeed.
Rotherham, police failed to stop the widespread sexual grooming and abuse of teenagers. In fact, an independent report concluded the evidence it was going on was suppressed. Now South Yorkshire Police is being investigated itself, one of 18 forces where officers are accused of failing to properly investigate child sexual abuse. The number of these inquiries being handled by the Independent Police Complaints Commission has been rising steadily. In total, there are 187. Rotherham means South Yorkshire Police is the subject of 56 inquiries. Essex Police is facing 58 cases, and the Metropolitan Police 46. 27 cases have been completed, with 13 officers facing disciplinary proceedings and 2 already disciplined. In London, many of the cases involved the claim that investigations were closed down when police discovered connections to MPs or other prominent people. The police watchdog says it's examining allegations of historic high-level corruption. But in May, one claim that a prosecution was stopped when a defendant threatened to name the former Prime Minister, Sir Edward Heath, as an abuser, was dismissed by the IPCC. The suggestion that the powerful have been protected by the police is far from the claim that investigations were closed down when police discovered connections to MPs or other prominent people.
Claims professional footballers were assaulted by a paedophile when they were children.
In regards to the amount of people that come forward in a short space of time, it makes me feel that this is the tip of the iceberg.
The Professional Footballers Association has called for a full inquiry into the sexual abuse of young players. Well, our correspondent Paul Kelso is live at Wembley for us. And Paul, it does certainly feel as though this story is gathering momentum, more people likely to come forward.
Yes, and all of this was triggered by a man called Andy Woodward, a former player with clubs in the Northwest, a professional player who has come forward with claims that he was abused by a convicted paedophile who worked as a coach at a number of clubs in the Northwest in the 70s and 1980s. And it was Andy Woodward's interview given to The Guardian last week, which was the trigger for a number of other players to come forward, some of them on the record, which is unusual and takes a great deal of bravery, of course, and many others to come forward still with anonymity. We know that Cheshire Police have had at least 11 people contact them with information relating to abuse within football. Now, Andy Woodward has been here at Wembley today meeting with the FA's chairman, Greg Clark, and I spoke to him after that meeting, which Andy Woodward said he was extremely pleased with the reception he received. He was glad the FA wanted to hear him out and that they have offered to support him and all the other victims of abuse within the game that are coming forward. And he's encouraged, above all, other players who've encountered abuse to pick up the phone.
It's not just me that's been brave. Every single one of them have been brave. And they are, honestly, there's a word for it. I say it to Zelda, they're warriors. They are. To do this, I'm so proud of them. But I also know that there's more out there. And there is more high-profile people that are sat there thinking on whether can I or can't I. You don't have to be named. You don't have to put yourself on the front of a paper. But you do need to get closure. And I do know they're out there. And I just encourage them to, you know, pick up the phone, ring up and just say, you know, I was a victim. Because here in the background, I'm doing all this work to try and get us all the proper help that we deserve.
Hard to underestimate the amount of bravery and commitment it's required for Andy Woodward to come forward and keep giving interviews day after day to try and keep this story and this issue with the level of profile it's receiving now. But he's very determined to do so because he believes there are not singles, not tens, but he believes there are hundreds of people who are in the same position which he found himself, bottling up and being silent about abuse for many years. Now, of course, this all raises questions for the governing body of football in this country, the Football Association, which is trying to fashion an appropriate response. We've seen other sectors, other areas of public life have to face up to this issue in recent years, and it is now very much football's turn. My understanding is that they will not be launching an inquiry, a wide-reaching look back into the past at this stage, because at the moment they want to focus on working with the police. Cheshire Police have launched an investigation. They've asked the Football Association to support that investigation, and that's what the FA are going to do. And in the next hour or so, we should be hearing from Greg Clark, the chairman, who met with Andy Woodward this afternoon, has offered him all the support he can to get a sense of exactly how English football and the FA is going to provide some leadership at a time in which the game is facing up to really difficult, difficult issues that are only just beginning to emerge.
OK, Paul, thanks very much. And look, this is a story that isn't going to go away. We're going to be speaking to the Shadow Sports Minister between now and 5 o'clock, so do stay with us for that.
Eventually, you know, we might be able to get a true understanding of what happened at that football club. Because me and Steve know, and so do many more, and we will find out, and it will come out.
not just me that's been brave, every single one of them have been brave. And they are, honestly, there's a word for it, I say it to Zelda, they're warriors, they are. To do this, I'm so proud of them. But I also know that there's more out there, and there is more high-profile people that are sat there thinking on whether can I or can't I. You don't have to be named. You don't have to put yourself on the front of a paper, but you do need to get closure. And I do know they're out there, and I just encourage them to, you know, pick up the phone, ring up and just say, you know, I was a victim. Because here in the background, I'm doing all this work to try and get us all the proper help that we deserve. Moving forward, with the encouragement I've had from the FA this morning and Greg Clark, is that, you know, we are going to make a difference, and we're going to make a difference to a lot of people and a lot of children out there.
Well, he was speaking to our sports correspondent Paul Kelso, who's live at Wembley for us this afternoon. And Paul, a bit of a watershed moment, it feels like, for football, as more and more people coming forward.
Yes, Andy Woodward, who you heard from there, has unblocked a dam, it seems, and flooding through the gap that he's created following his example, speaking out about the abuse, the terrible abuse that he received at the hands of a convicted paedophile, are a number of other footballers. We've had three other former professionals come forward and speak on the record. Two of them who played for England in the past few days since Andy Woodward first spoke out. I understand that others are coming and others are prepared to speak publicly. Not just those who are coming out publicly, many, many more privately coming forward, either talking to the NSPCC helpline that the Football Association has established in the last 24 hours. It only went live this morning, already 50 calls it took before lunchtime, and also 11 people at least who have spoken to Cheshire Police. So this is a moment that the football business, the football industry, is having to face what other sectors of public life have had to face in recent years, which is the dark shadow of child abuse. Now, the FA chairman, Greg Clark, has just spoken to us, and I put it to him, I asked that question, is the FA willing to look this issue in the eye and take the responsibility that perhaps it did not take 15, 20 years ago when these allegations, when these convictions were first made? This is what he said.
Not only will we not flinch, we won't seek to blame anybody. What we've got to do is to make sure that those victims are supported, that this doesn't turn into an exercise by football trying to protect its own reputation. Our job is to protect the victims and make sure there are no more victims. And we'll take that on the chin, we'll hold ourselves to account, we'll work closely with the police and the victims, and I will meet any victim who comes forward, as I met one today.
So Greg Clark was clearly very touched and struck by Andy Woodward when they met at Wembley for nearly 2 hours, I understand, today. Greg Clark says he's going to take personal control of this. There are a few concrete steps he has taken. He today, along with the Football League and the Premier League, have written to all their clubs. Now, the FA licenses 30,000 clubs across England. He's written to all of them to stress how seriously they take these allegations and to remind all of them of their responsibilities when it comes to child protection, because while this issue has emerged at the top of the professional game, and that's what's made it so striking and so newsworthy perhaps, there are hundreds of thousands of children who play football every weekend, most of them under the guidance of volunteer coaches. There's a system of criminal record checks in place, and there are safeguarding courses that coaches are supposed to take. But there is, if you like, a huge vulnerability, a huge opportunity seen perhaps at its starkest in youth football, and the FA wants to make sure it has got every measure in place it has to try and deal with this. So the FA, speaking for the first time, are trying to fashion an appropriate response, but this is a story that really is yet to play out in full. More footballers will come forward and speak publicly, and the game is going to have to confront its past, and everyone watching will hope that they are unflinching in dealing with it.
Absolutely. Paul, thanks very much indeed. Well, let's discuss some of the issues that Paul was talking about there with Dr. Rosanna Ellen Khan. She is the Shadow Sports Minister and joins us now on the programme. A very good evening to you. We were hearing from Paul there that this has somewhat blindsided the sport. How surprised are you by all of this?
Well, I'm deeply alarmed by it. I mean, football pitches are supposed to be a place of safety, not a place for sexual predators. But, and I commend the bravery for all those footballers who've spoken out thus far.
And we obviously saw with the Savile scandal that it snowballed and more victims came forward and found courage from other people coming forward. Do you think that this could be, as some people have been saying, the tip of the iceberg?
I do worry that that indeed may be the case, and we need to encourage people to come forward. We need to create a safe space for them to be able to do so, and we need to make sure that action is taken against the perpetrators.
Well, let's talk about what action should be taken. We heard from the FA just then. They're saying that they would welcome an inquiry. Do we think that this is a good idea? Who needs to bring an inquiry? Would it be the government?
Well, I'm so glad that the FA are really jumping on this straight away, and I think that an inquiry needs to be called for. I think the FA needs to work in conjunction with regional associations, but we need to look at what we can do together with schools, together with government, together with the police, together with local clubs, right from Sunday League to Premier League, to make sure that we literally stamp down on this and make sure that it's not happening any further.
And what do you think has been going wrong? How has it been allowed to happen for so long?
I think we up until now have not perhaps had the culture for young people to teach them that they can come and let us know when things are going wrong. I mean, we need to understand that coaches and officials, 99.9% of whom are honest and have children's best interests at heart, they are role models. And many of these children and young people rely on these people to help fulfill a career in sport that they could only dream of having. So we need to make sure that we create a safe space and we improve education so that our young people and children can come forward and tell us when they're concerned.
And what about this issue of mandatory reporting? I know that Andy Woodward said he is confident that other people know about abuses that are going on within football. Do you think it should become a legal requirement that if somebody in authority hears and understands about some form of abuse, that that is automatically then referred on to the authorities?
I believe it needs to be. We need to make sure that our children and young people are protected. Parents need assurances that their children are safe. I have two young children, both of whom play football and rely on wonderful volunteer coaches. And I want to be able to send them into the football arena knowing that they're safe. And I know that every other parent out there wants the same.
We've heard from the National Association of Karate and Martial Arts this afternoon. In fact, we're going to be speaking to them on this programme shortly. And they've raised the issue of what used to be known as the CRB checks, but have been changed to DBS checks, which basically looks into the background of a particular adult that's working with children and looks at their suitability and whether they are in any way inappropriate to be dealing with children. They are saying that they have extreme concerns about the DBS checks. They claim that they've been watered down by the coalition government. And they believe that it is leading to delays in people who are dealing with children who've got things to hide coming to the fore. Is that a concern that you share?
I do share it, and it does actually take a long time for a DBS check to go through, and quite often many people start work on the goodwill understanding that their DBS check is coming anytime soon. But we need to make sure 100% that our young people, that our vulnerable youth, are protected.
And do you think that the DBS needs to be strengthened into the traditional CRB check? Or what is the best way to ensure that those people that are dealing with our children are not going to be doing exactly what they've been doing in the cases of Andy Woodward and the other three professional footballers, and indeed 11 people who've spoken to Cheshire Police and 50 people who've made calls to the NSPCC just today alone?
Yeah. I think it's multifactorial. I think, yes, we need to have good, robust checks like the DBS and the CRB checks. But I think we also need to make sure that perpetrators know that we will come down really hard on them should they be found out. We also need to make sure that we train our young people and educate them to be able to come forward in a safe environment to let us know if they're at all concerned. And we need to roll this out as soon as possible.
And just finally, one last answer from you, if I can. Do you have any concerns that this could be sports-wide, not just limited to football?
Well, clearly, football is in the fore today, but any sport that requires children and young people to have access to coaches who they see as role models need to be protected. We need to make sure that we ensure the safety of all of these children and young people across the board in all sports in the UK.
OK, Dr. Rosanna Allen-Khan, the Shadow Sports Minister, really good to talk to you this afternoon.
Thank you very much.
abuse of young players. It's raised concerns about the safeguarding and vetting measures in place at children's sports clubs. Well, let's talk now to Joe Ellis. He's the chairman of the National Association of Karate and Martial Arts Schools. You may wonder what the link is straight away, but really good to talk to you this evening. You issued a press release earlier on today to say that you were extremely concerned about the way that individuals that are working with children are screened. Tell us more.
That's correct. Yes, we've had some difficulties for some years since the coalition took place some years ago with the Liberal Democrats and Conservative Party. They've changed the way the procedures work. So nowadays, you ask the applicant to declare the convictions following a receipt from a disclosure certificate from the Home Office rather than the other way around. As far back as last year, we had the Minister for the Prevention of Abuse and Exploitation of Kids, Children, Karen Bradley MP, admitting to me by letter via our MP, so Roger Gale MP, saying that clearly there's issues and she will take a personal overview, but she hasn't done that.
And have you got any reason to have concerns about this kind of thing going on within karate and the martial arts?
Well, we've seen some very serious issues in our own art, in our own sport over the last few years, and particularly last year was a high-profile case where a martial arts instructor in the UK was convicted for serious offences against rape and against a young girl. He got 15 years. Had we known earlier, or had people known earlier, that he had a previous issue, that it could have been identified sooner.
So your concerns then are very serious. How surprised then are you that this issue has been raised within the football industry?
What we've seen over the last day or two is the FA from the professional football side of it. But actually, I fear that the grassroots of sport, FA, the football, the martial arts, or any other community organisation, actually it's the tip of the iceberg. And it really does need to be addressed. And I think the Home Office actually needs to put its finger on the pulse a bit more with the disclosure service and actually deal with the serious errors that it's got, as opposed to leaving it as it is at the moment.
And would you like to see a return to the traditional CRB checks that were replaced with this DBS system by, as you say, the coalition? Did that work, the CRB checks? Were they better, in your view?
Actually, we are a registered body with this, the disclosure. It's almost the same. In some ways, it's advanced. We have an issue in Scotland where we are informed about someone who's got a child abuse, or we've had a child conviction, that they tell us, but the English equivalent, the DBS, don't. They used to, but they don't nowadays. And I think actually the minister for this department, she really does need to revamp it. Otherwise, what you've seen recently over the last day or two is going to escalate. As I said, it is a tip of the iceberg. There are people out there that haven't been disclosed, haven't been checked for criminal records, and actually it places children at risk.
OK, and just finally, a yes or no, would you like to see a full inquiry into what's gone on and what's been reported so far, certainly just within football?
Yes, absolutely.
OK, Joe Ellis, really good to talk to you. Thank you for flagging your concerns and taking the time to talk to us on Sky News.
Thank you.
Well, meanwhile, we have had a statement from the Sports Minister, Tracy Crouch, this evening. She says the players that have broken their silence to speak out about the abuse they suffered have shown incredible bravery. The safety and security of participants in sport at every level is absolutely paramount. Sports governing bodies, clubs and coaches have a clear duty of care to young people who attend sports clubs. She went on to say the Child Protection in Sport Unit has standards for safeguarding and protecting children in sport that sports organisations have to adhere to. Well, I want to bring you a little bit of breaking news that we've been getting here at Sky News in the last few moments in relation to Barry Bennell, who, of course, has been accused of assaulting Andy Woodward, allegedly. Now, Manchester City have issued this statement in the last few moments. They're saying the club is aware of allegations that Barry Bennell had an association with Manchester City Football Club in the 1980s. As a result, the club is currently undertaking a thorough investigation of any past links he may have had with the organisation. Well, let's talk to Paul Kelso. He is live for us this evening at Wembley. And this, I suppose, is playing into what we all feared, which is that this could snowball a little bit, Paul, and that we may hear more and more cases in the coming days.
Yes, further evidence that this is a story that began with one man, Andy Woodward, who we heard from there, who was brave enough to speak out publicly, to waive his anonymity that he's had ever since he appeared at a criminal trial that saw Barry Bennell convicted. And he has unblocked, he's ended a shameful silence in the English game. And this story is going to run and spread. We've seen other footballers come forward, three more going public on the record about their experiences, two of them claiming also to have been abused by Barry Bennell. Crewe Alexandra at the football club where Andy Woodward was based when he first encountered Bennell, they've had to address this, and now it's spreading to Manchester City. Bennell was active in a network of clubs in the northwest, finding and sourcing young talent, which many of those clubs were more than happy to take on their books, understanding this was a man who's providing them with football talent. We of course know now, and has been known, was known at the time of his trial, that he of course was abusing children. But Manchester City, one of the biggest clubs in the country, now having to address this, and this surely is going to spread, and the ramifications of this story will continue to grow. And that of course poses a challenge for the Football Association here at Wembley, who have somehow, amid a story that is moving very fast and the depths of which we still don't quite know, they have to find an appropriate response on behalf of the English game, which clearly now appears to be facing the kind of challenge over child abuse that other areas of British public life have faced in the last 2 years. They've spoken for the first time this evening. Chairman Greg Clark met with Andy Woodward at Wembley earlier this afternoon. They spoke for a couple of hours, and afterwards we asked Greg Clark whether the Football Association was willing to look into its past as well as addressing the challenges now around making sure children are safe.
Not only will we not flinch, we won't seek to blame anybody. What we've got to do is to make sure that those victims are supported, that this doesn't turn into an exercise by football trying to protect its own reputation. Our job is to protect the victims and make sure there are no more victims. And we'll take that on the chin, we'll hold ourselves to account, we'll work closely with the police and the victims, and I will meet any victim who comes forward, as I met one today.
Greg Clark is going to meet any victim who wants to speak to him. He may not be short of people requesting his time. There are more professional players, high-profile players, preparing to come forward and speak publicly in the media. The NSPCC and the Football Association set up a helpline. It had been live for just 2 hours this morning when it had received 50 calls already, and the police have at least 11 people who've come forward with information. This feels very much like the beginning of a very dark chapter for English football, when it's going to have to face up to the very recent past, less than 20 years ago, when it appears abuse was rampant in certain areas of the game, certainly around one individual, and very little at the time was done by the game to address that.
OK, Paul, thanks very much.
Well, let's talk to Dr. Daniel Rind. He's a lecturer from Brunel University who specialises in safeguarding in sport. He joins me via webcam from West London. Dr. Rind, good of you to be with us. I grew up watching Paul Stewart. He was a fantastic footballer at Liverpool and all through his career, and there was never any clue of what he'd suffered until that very emotional interview is done with Dan today. So if he has come forward, and if we didn't know about him, how many others are there?
Well, I'm afraid I would agree with Paul Stewart in that this could be something bigger than the Jimmy Savile case, because football, when we look at abuse, we know that it happens when power meets vulnerability. When we look at it, the football culture, coaches can be in a very significant position of power based on their reputation, the position they're in at clubs, and the power they have over the contracts and the future of young players. When we look at the player side of the coin, if you like, they invest a great deal of time. They really want to be the next great player. And so that puts them in a very vulnerable position. So between those two, it's a perfect storm for abuse to happen.
Your speciality is safeguarding in sport. How receptive has football been to safeguarding its youngsters?
I think more recently they've taken great strides with a real commitment with the safeguarding department. And I think they are the envy of many countries around the world. So that they've learned from the cases that have happened in the past, they have put things in place. Clearly there's more work to do and things aren't perfect, but safeguarding is a journey, not a destination, so we're always moving towards safer positions, and always there's new challenges and new risks that are coming along.
Paul Stewart epitomised that macho image of football. Do you think it's that same image there that's made it harder for other footballers to come forward?
Absolutely. It can be, if you imagine the situation that he was in, it's very challenging, and many barriers that can be put up around a young person, whether from having the vocabulary to even explain what's happening to somebody else, and then that person to believe them and to be able to prioritise that over the reputation of a club or the sport, and to genuinely believe them, to go through all of those barriers to get to a stage where they can actually be believed. It's easy to understand why things maybe get kept secret, and they think that it's their career on the line, and hence they better not risk that by telling people at the time.
Yeah. We understand from Dan tonight that there are two more footballers that are going to give up their anonymity tomorrow, and they're going to come forward and speak to the BBC. I suppose the more high-profile the footballers are that come forward, the more it will encourage others to do the same.
Absolutely, and the message I would say is clear, that silence protects the wrong person. So we need people to come forward, tell their story, and to be believed, and now is the time. As we saw with the Jimmy Savile case, many people came forward, they realised that they were being believed, they realised that there was support in place. And so we know from our research that there's a lot more abuse is happening in prevalence terms than is coming forward. For example, the NSPCC study in 2011 found that 5% of young boys reported having been sexually abused in organised youth sport. So 5%, that means there's one boy on every football pitch, cricket pitch, rugby pitch in the country that has experienced sexual abuse, and that's not coming through to the disclosures and the courts and the police. So there's a big vacuum between what we think is happening and what we know is happening in terms of the cases that are being managed.
And of course, the evidence suggests that boys are less likely to come forward than girls.
Absolutely. It's both within sport and beyond. It's often challenging for boys to have the language and the confidence and to be believed. And in safeguarding, the research also indicates that boys are more likely to be abused than girls, and often the stereotype would be the other way around. But in the research that we did in 2014 about the cases of abuse in sport, actually 65% of victims were boys. So actually boys are more risk of abuse in sport, particularly in football, because there's perhaps more participants playing. And so we need to give them the opportunities and the language and the channels through which they can disclose to other people.
I heard Pat Nevin speaking on Radio 5 Live a little early, and he was saying, of course, it's not about professional footballers as well. There'll be a lot who've gone through clubs such as Paul Stewart who didn't make the grade and may be yet to come forward. So it's important the FA takes the right stance. So are you impressed by what they've done today, the statements we've heard from the FA chairman?
Absolutely. I think they've acted swiftly and shown clear leadership with Greg Clark coming out and speaking very candidly, and great that he's met those victims. And so in the short term, with the help of the hotline, I think that's exactly the right thing to do. The key is to now look back and learn from those mistakes, and what can we do to challenge that culture so that if the same predatory paedophile was to try and enter the sport, it'd be much more barriers in place, and it wouldn't go to the extremes that these to suffer. So it's in the short term that they're doing the right thing. Now it's ensuring that that feeds into a longer-term plan to really embed safeguarding across football in the UK.
And just a very, very quick one to finish, and I probably should have asked you this earlier. Are football coaches within clubs subject to the same checks that teachers or Cub Scout leaders or that sort of thing? Are they all subject to the same checks?
Yeah, there'll be the same background criminal check, but one difference is that they're in a position of power, but in other sectors of community, the age of consent would be 18, whereas coaches is not classed as that position of power, so the age of consent is still 16. So there is that discrepancy between sport and other positions of trust like teachers and doctors, etc.
OK. Dr. Daniel Ryan, very interesting. Thank you for coming on and sharing your thoughts with us this evening.
Football, that a number of claims of historical sexual abuse against former coaches in the game could be the start of something much, much bigger. So far, four former professionals have come forward. Today, the chairman of the FA said he wanted any other victims to have the confidence to do the same.
For decades, they have carried the secrets of what they suffered as young players trying to make the grade. Now they're determined to shine a light on one of football's darkest, most shameful places. Andy Woodward has an appointment at Wembley. Not the sort he dreamt of as a player, but a visit to English football's headquarters to discuss the abuse he suffered as a youth player and to ask for help for all who suffered as he did.
We do deserve it, you know. We went through hell
And, you know, I've spoken to them. It's like when I start talking about them, I get really emotional because they've all suffered as me, and I'm still suffering now myself.
Young footballers were preyed on. The scale of exploitation dating back to the 70s only now becoming clear. Paul Stewart, who went on to play for England, has revealed he was systematically abused by his youth coach. David White of Manchester City in England says the same happened to him. Steve Walters, who played for Crewe Alexandra, tells a similar horrific story, while it was Andy Woodward, also ex-Crewe, who first broke years of silent suffering. Three of those players have named former talent scout and youth coach Barry Bennell as their abuser. He had links to clubs like Crewe Alexandra, Stoke City and Manchester City. In 1998, he was sentenced to 9 years in prison after pleading guilty to sexual offences against boys as young as nine. Ian Ackley was one of Bennell's victims, the abuse starting when he was just 10 and being taken by his coach for trials at clubs like Manchester City.
I was raped hundreds of times. I'd go on a Friday and not come back till a Sunday. He'd often make excuses that the weather was bad or there's some reason why I should stay over for more days so I'd miss school. So, you know, it was anywhere and everywhere that he could take advantage, really.
20 years ago, Ian Ackley gave evidence against Bennell. Back then, he says the football authorities ignored the problem.
It was a dirty little subject that people wanted to get done with and brushed away under the carpet. No one wanted to be associated with anything.
The current FA chairman says they're listening now.
We're going to make sure that no stone is left unturned in making sure that there isn't a new generation of victims and the victims who have been hurt are truly helped.
And an apology would be a good start, this victim says.
I think it's about time people actually said, yes, we made a mistake. We didn't keep these children safe.
But at least now, people are starting to take notice.
And Paul is at the FA headquarters in Wembley tonight. Paul, you heard some pretty harrowing testimony there in your report from Ian Ackley, having been saying he'd been raped hundreds of times. And the FA taking these claims seriously now.
Yes, Raggy, it does seem that after years of inertia, denial even, that this disturbing issue is at last being addressed. The FA chairman has told us that as well as helping those ex-players who are still suffering from abuse they suffered as youngsters, he's written today to all his clubs, big and small, 30,000 of them, warning them to tighten up their safeguards to protect today's young players. Of course, it's all happening because of those players who are coming forward and saying that this happened to them when they were youngsters. There's a real momentum there and it is growing. Tonight, a former player from Newcastle United has said that he too was abused as a junior by his youth coach. And I understand that two new players will be coming forward tomorrow to tell the world of their experiences.
Paul at Wembley, thank you very much indeed. An issue that is gathering momentum. Thank you, Paul.
Abuse cases are poorly handled by the Met Police, and that's according to HMIC. Now, one of the issues that it raises here is that the force has been more focused on burglary and vehicle theft. Now, those things are important, but are they as important as child protection? Well, I would argue absolutely not. And they've only taken a sample of cases here, so we need to hear from the Met whether they think that was fair. But they've 38 had to be referred for further investigation because they represented a continued risk to a child or children.
However, and you're right, this is top priority. There are a couple of points need to be made here. Police officers feel that HMIC has been politicised with the appointments of the former rail regulator, Tom Windsor, who went on to do a wide-ranging review on police performance and so forth. And they feel that they have been overly critical. We saw last year HMIC put out a report suggesting that licensed firearms holders were likely to be involved in all sorts of mass shootings due to failures. Now, it seems that there have been failures here. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, when you have cuts or anything up to 40%, yes, when somebody makes these allegations, they need investigating. When your house gets burgled, it needs investigating. Frankly, the police police is not something you can save money on, frankly, if we want to investigate these things and what matters to all of us as taxpayers. If you call a cop, you should get a cop, surely.
There's one thing in this story as well. They picked out two cases, and one of them, officers had wrongly closed the case of a 13-year-old girl believed to be sexually active with older men. Of course, at 13, you cannot consent.
Never.
And they didn't speak to the child. And I think there's an attitudinal thing that we also have to address here. We saw it with Rotherham. Mm. There was a sort of belief that these were girls who were a certain kind of girl. Mm-hmm. And we've really got to address that, because if we want people to come forward, they've got to know they won't just be dismissed like that.
It can't, it's not acceptable.
But you're talking about resources. I mean, Operation Midland was a £2.5 million investigation.
Yes.
There was no shortage of resources there.
No, but it's politics.
It came up with no arrests.
No, but again,
it's politics, isn't it?
Because it is process, but ultimately, the theory is that politics is separate from policing. The reality is, of course, very different. And you can look back to when the former Prime Minister, David Cameron, for reasons we can understand, wanted resources put into the investigation of Madeleine McCann. He said he had asked told the Met Commissioner to investigate. That then becomes a massive political issue because theoretically they're supposed to be separate. Now, ultimately, we don't just want to have a charade put on so that we can see things are being investigated. They need to be properly investigated, and the money needs to be there for absolutely all areas. Burglaries, whether it's car thefts, but certainly child protection, all of it.
Mm. The trouble is, if you look at the rest of the front pages, there ain't much money around,
no,
is there?
No, right. Absolutely not.
They're talking about borrowing going up, and maybe our borrowing going up as well, because our pay is being squeezed. But most notably, the pay of the lowest paid in the country.